Hello, dear learners. Today we are going to have a discussion on dimensions of learning, and this is the first part of the lecture. I'm Dr. Aerum, Assistant Professor in IASC, Faculty of Education, Jamia Millia Islamia, New Delhi. Today we are going to have a discussion on dimensions of learning, and first of all, we will be checking out that what exactly Marzano has told us about it. And also there will be a discussion on Bloom's taxonomy of thinking skills. But we will be discussing Marzano's dimensions of learning first in this first part of the lecture. And in the second part, we will be discussing about Bloom's taxonomy of thinking skills. So let us see that what exactly is dimension of learning, the opinion of Marzano about the dimension of learning. So Marzano's categories of how people think is different from Bloom's in that the categories do not build upon each other. Each cognitive category is just as important as the others. The dimensions of learning represent elements that Marzano believes are all worthy of focus and inclusion within a unit of study. So what are the dimensions of learning according to Marzano? How we can now actually make an inculcation? The dimensions of learning is a comprehensive model that uses what researchers and theorists know about learning to define the learning process. It is an extension of the comprehensive research-based framework on cognition and learning described in the famous work of Marzano in 1988. And this work was titled as Dimensions of Thinking, a Framework for Curriculum and Instruction. This was the famous work of Marzano. Now, the question is that what are the five dimensions of learning? These are basically essential to successful learning. What they can do, these dimension frameworks will help a teacher to maintain a focus on learning, study the learning process, and plan the curriculum, instruction, and assessment that takes into account five critical aspects of learning. So now we will see that what exactly the first dimension says. The first dimension of this particular aspect is attitudes and perceptions. Attitudes and perceptions affect students' abilities to learn. For example, if students view the classroom as an unsafe and clumsy place, they will likely learn very little. Similarly, if students have negative attitudes about classroom tasks, they will probably put little effort into those tasks. A key element of effective instruction then is helping students to establish positive attitudes and perceptions about the classroom and about learning. So this is something whenever we are talking about these dimensions, attitudes and perceptions, we have to see that what exactly the attitudes and perceptions are likely to have. So under the attitudes and perceptions, the first aspect is the classroom climate. In the classroom climate, we have to see the acceptance by teachers and peers, how the child is accepted by the teachers and how good this child is having a friendship in the class, and the peer group are actually making a kind of a cooperation with this child. So under the classroom climate, we have acceptance by teachers and peers, and comfort and order, how orderly the classroom is and how much comfortable this child is in the classroom. So under this attitudes and perceptions, classroom, after the classroom climate, we have what? Classroom tasks. What is exactly the classroom task? Whatever assignment or whatever work is given to the child to undergo. So in that, whenever we are giving the classroom task, we have to see that what are the values enshrined, what are the values and interests which this child is having. So whether the this particular assignment is in coherence with this child's interest and values or not. Then we have to see the ability and the resources. So how able this child is to actually complete this task which is given, because the motivation of the child for the further studies and for the further assignments is depending on the completion of this assignment. So how this child is able to do, and then what are the resources which are responsible, like which are actually useful to accomplish this task, whether the resources are available to this child or not. Then we have to see that how clear the teacher is while giving the assignment. If the task is clear to the child, he or she will try to complete it. But if there is no clarity, then there will be a possibility that the child is not able to complete the assignment. Now we will see the second dimension. What is the second dimension? It is to acquire and integrate knowledge. So when students are learning new knowledge, they must be guided in relating the new knowledge to what they already know, or what is the previous knowledge which is already there. Because we actually know that the new knowledge is basically the manifestation of which the child is already having. So this previous knowledge has to be organized. So the child is organizing the previous knowledge along with the new knowledge and then making it part of their long-term memory. When students are acquiring new skills and processes, they must learn it in a very orderly fashion. They must learn a model or a set of steps. Then they shape the skill or process to make it efficient and effective for them. And finally, internalize or practice the skill or process so they can perform it easily. So there should be an order which is to be maintained whenever we are actually teaching something to a child. So that when the next time we are giving some sort of application based question or some sort of exercise to the child, on the basis of whatever this child has learned earlier, he or she can be in a position to accomplish that particular task. So under this second dimension, which is acquire and integrate knowledge, we will see that there are two different types of ways of knowledges which we actually give to the child. The first type is declarative knowledge, where the child basically constructs the meaning of what new knowledge is introduced to him or her on the basis of what is learned by him or her earlier, or whatever experience this child is having previously. So this construction of meaning happens first, then there is the organization of this new knowledge in a particular manner. So the organization happens, and once the organization is done, then it is stored. The knowledge is stored in the long-term memory. So this was the declarative task. And then we have got the procedural knowledge. So what is this procedural knowledge, or the procedural approach, which is actually the part of this dimension number two? Basically, under the procedural knowledge, we construct models, or we actually make different steps in which this new knowledge can be understood by this child. So if there is a formula of mathematics or something, or if a theorem of mathematics, for basically solving this theorem, the child goes step by step, so that on the based on this particular theorem, if some exercise is given to this child later on, she or he can solve it on the basis of whatever model she has learned earlier. So constructs models, then makes a shape. It will be learned in a proper manner, step by step manner, and then in this step by step manner is internalized. So in this way, this acquiring and integration of knowledge happens. So this was the second dimension. Now we will see that what exactly is the third dimension. So the third dimension is to extend and refine knowledge. Learning does not stop with acquiring and integrating knowledge. Learners develop in-depth understanding through the process of extending and refining their knowledge. For example, by making new distinctions, clearing up misconceptions and alternative frameworks, and reaching to conclusions, they rigorously analyze what they have learned by applying reasoning process that will help them extend and refine the information. Some of the common reasoning process used by learners to extend and refine their knowledge can be like we can state it in this way. You can see that here I have written few of those points. So these are the first thing which this child will do under the category of extend and refine knowledge will be comparing. So the comparing will happen, then there will be classification or classifying, then abstracting and inductive reasoning, then there will be deductive reasoning, then constructing support, analyzing errors, analyzing perspectives. So here in this step-by-step fashion, this child is going to make the extension and refinement of the knowledge. So all these steps will be taken care of whenever the child is extending the knowledge. Now let us see what is the next dimension, or the fourth dimension. The fourth dimension is using knowledge meaningfully. Using knowledge meaningfully, the most effective learning occurs when we use knowledge to perform meaningful tasks. For example, we might initially learn about a skincare product by talking to a friend or viewing an advertisement in a magazine. But when we are about to buy the product, we actually learn a lot about it. We actually go and seek much more information that how this product will work and what will be the efficiency of this work, how it will be good for me. So all these things we do when we are actually going to buy it. So we use our knowledge in a very meaningful way whenever it is required to us. So making sure that students have the opportunity to use knowledge meaningfully is one of the most important parts of planning a unit of instruction. In the dimensions of learning model, there are six reasoning processes around which tasks can be constructed to encourage the meaningful use of knowledge. So now we will see what exactly these are. So for using knowledge meaningfully, first of all, we have to make a decision. So decision making happens. Then we see that how this particular decision is going to solve our problem. So problem solving happens. Then we see that in which way we are actually going to make some kind of novel inventions by taking this decision. Our problems are solved and we are going to do something new. So this the step which is next to this problem solving is invention. Then we have got experimental inquiry. We used to see that like in case of this buying the skin care product, we actually in most of the cases we make a kind of inquiry that how people were, those who were using it earlier, were facing, like how good this was for others. So that type of experimental inquiry happens. Then we go and investigate. Maybe we do a Google search and see that what exactly is the composition of this particular product and what how good it is for the skin and all. And then we do the system analysis where we actually go and check all each and all information which is actually written on the page of which is on this particular skincare product on the Google or on the packet of this product. So we do a proper analysis. So in this way we are using our knowledge meaningfully to inquire something which is some information or something which is useful for us. So this was the fourth dimension. Then we will come to the fifth dimension or last dimension, which is habits of mind. So we will see that the most effective learners have developed powerful habits of mind that enable them to think critically, think creatively, and regulate their behavior. These mental habits are listed, like here I have listed few of those activities. So the first activity which is listed here is critical thinking. What exactly we do in the critical thinking? We have to be very accurate and seek accuracy when we are making a critical thinking attempt. So the first thing which we do is be accurate and seek accuracy. Then be very clear and seek clarity. Then maintain an open mind. restrain impulsivity, take a position when the situation warrants it, respond appropriately to others' feelings and level of knowledge. So this is under the basically the critical thinking. Then whenever we are making a kind of attempt for doing the creative thinking, what exactly we do? We actually persevere. We push the limits of our knowledge and abilities, generate trust, and maintain our own standards of evaluation. We generate new ways of viewing a situation which is outside the boundaries of standard conventions. So these are the things which we do under the creative thinking. And then we have the self-regulating thinking. Self-regulated thinking, under this, we monitor our own thinking, we plan appropriately, and we identify and use necessary resources, respond appropriately to feedback, we evaluate the effectiveness of our actions. So this was the next aspect which we have to see, which we had seen in the dimensions of learning's fifth dimension. So with this, we have come to a summary. Like, we are going to summarize this particular lecture. Through this discussion, we learned about the views of Marzano in terms of dimensions of learning. In the next discussion, we will see how Marzano presented these dimensions into a model. Then we will discuss the Bloom's taxonomy of thinking skills to understand more effectively the whole concept of dimensions of learning. Hope you all have understood the points covered in today's lecture. See you again. Thank you.